You heard from the speakers just what an optimistic time it is for energy in Ontario and in Canada. But usually as Canadians, we're pretty humble. But sometimes in that humility, we forget actually these amazing attributes that we have as a country, whether they're in our communities, whether it's our technology, but most importantly, our people. And that's really what I wanna talk about here today. Maybe before I start, really want to share some information and a broader sense. We often talk about what's going on here in Ontario and here in Canada, but we have to recognize we're part of an integrated world, and the energy opportunities that we have here in Ontario, some of the challenges we have here in Ontario, are not that different from the rest of the world, and it's some of the same things that are driving those. The world is experiencing a massive growth in demand for electricity. We're experiencing a large growth in population, but also a technological change which is moving to more electrification. So with that brings a challenge. If other countries in the world, as much as we are in a strong place right now in Ontario, and we'll talk about this on a comparative basis, if other countries in the world that are developing follow the same path of building their energy systems as we have done in many Western countries, we will not be successful in fighting climate change. 75% growth expected for electricity by 2050. To put that in perspective, that's about 3 to 4 cities the size of Toronto. And that's the expected growth of electricity. Now, when you look at that, I always like to say that, you know, because look, I like fighting for my side. I'm as you can tell, I'm pretty pro-nuclear. To meet that challenge, we need an all-the-above strategy. It's not just nuclear. We'll talk about the role that nuclear will play in that. We need everything. The challenge for us in Ontario is, how do we do this in a way, how do we meet this challenge in a way that maintains reliability? I just had the opportunity yesterday. I see the Mayor Godrich here. I've been kind of pestering for a long time to see who can get me a tour of the largest salt mine in the world, which is in Godrich, Ontario, by the way, just around the Bruce site. So we spent 3 hours, 800 meters underground and 6 kilometers out on Lake Huron. I'm dry, so, you know, the mine's operating okay. But believe it or not, the largest salt mine in Ontario, that salt mine runs 24/7. 75% of the equipment, the rotating equipment, unbelievable amounts of equipment in this mine, run off electricity. So reliability is what businesses in Ontario, families, our schools, our hospitals rely on. And so if we want to have a 24/7 economy, we need to have 24/7 electricity. And that's what our nuclear fleet here provides. So to meet this growth, reliability is absolutely important, because if we can't provide reliability, people will very quickly become comfortable with emitting sources that provide reliability. So the challenge is upon us to say, yes, we want to minimize greenhouse gases from our electricity sector, but we have to do it in a way that is reliable, because people deserve reliability. You know, if we wanted to have the lowest cost, highest reliability electricity system, we would just burn 100% coal, right? That's what we would do. When we phased out our coal units in Ontario, coal was 4 cents a kilowatt hour. But we recognize why that's not sustainable, why that's not viable. So what's important for us is to not only put a mix together that is reliable and clean, but to do it in a cost-effective way. And if you compare Ontario, that salt mine in Godrich, the price of power that they pay for electricity in the south, which we see here as Ontario Class A, is 9 cents a kilowatt hour. So it's lower cost than the adjoining Great Lakes states. So outside of the role that the government plays, why does Ontario have a high degree of reliability, and why does Ontario have a stability when it comes to price? It's because of the decisions that were made in the 1970s and the 1980s here in Ontario to build our nuclear fleet, to build our transmission lines, to build that infrastructure. My generation had a great, I always like to say, you know, very, very honored to grow up in the era that I did, because I benefited from all that infrastructure that my parents and my grandparents put into place in Ontario. And now we have that responsibility. But those investments that were put in place is what has put Ontario in this position now. That's not to say that we haven't done a lot of really amazing things over the last 10 years, but we are still harvesting and renewing a lot of the infrastructure that we put in place. So the vision that we've outlined around being an energy superpower and building for reliability, building for being clean, also is the right economic decision. We just have to be also thoughtful while we're doing this that the single top issue of Canadians and people, whether they're south of the border in the US or in Europe, the single greatest challenge most Canadians have right now is affordability. With interest rates high, with housing prices high, we know affordability is an important issue. So as we're advancing this, we have to be very mindful of that. If somebody can't put food on the table, they're not exactly as concerned about where their electricity is coming from. So the affordability is an important component here. We need to invest in infrastructure, but we need to use the tools and work with our government to moderate those prices, because we're making long-term investments, and over the long term, they will be the right thing to do. Energy security. So if we've learned anything with COVID-19, if we've learned anything when it comes to Russia's invasion of Ukraine, it's that energy security is really important. You can't have economic stability without energy security. And when we talk about Ontario's role here with our CANDU fleet, other technologies we're advancing, for example, the SMR at Darlington, we're also creating energy security. And people are not concerned about energy security until it's a problem. But when it's a problem, you're pretty darn happy you have it. And I can tell you, you may have heard from our new CEO, Eric Chassard, at his recent Empire Club speech. Eric's team did a fantastic job of carrying out our refurbishment project during the pandemic. One of the key enablers for that was a lot of suppliers in this room. You manufactured the components that we needed for major component replacement in Ontario. We were not worried about a border being closed. We manufactured those in Ontario. And I think that is really important. So we also have to think about this from an energy security. Our uranium comes from Saskatchewan. That energy security is really important, especially in a world of greater global instability. And that in itself is a major selling point for our province and Canada. I want to talk about medical isotopes. So this is obviously a massively expanding challenge and opportunity around the world. And just on Sunday, I think it was this weekend, Saturday or Sunday, can't remember the day, we celebrated the 73rd anniversary of the first cobalt cancer treatment that was done in London, Ontario. First cobalt beam cancer treatment done in London, Ontario. And since that day to here we are in 2024, Canada has been a world leader in the development, the production, and the use of medical isotopes. Without Canada, we would not have the type of cancer treatments, the types of cancer diagnostics that we have in the world today. We just wouldn't. The sad thing is 40% of us in this room will get cancer in our lives, but 100% of us will be impacted by cancer. All of this means that we need a supply of medical isotopes that is reliable. And our CANDU reactors provide an unprecedented, unique ability to provide that at scale. If Canada cannot step up to this, no one else can. And that's not an arrogant statement, that's a reflection of the technology we have here. And with this nuclear foundation we have, it's not only a unique opportunity, but a responsibility. But just before I wrap up, there's another important component here that I really do want to be direct about. And that is the Bruce site is an amazing nuclear site. But we have to also recognize, in the spirit of truth and reconciliation, that when the site was constructed 50 years ago, it was not done in partnership with First Nations, and it's on their territory. And so we have made a commitment as a company that we want the next 50 years to be different than the last 50 years. And we have a lot of work to do. This is a start to that. We're doing work on our existing assets that ties in with this, and we want to increase SON's participation and involvement and frankly benefit from the site. And as we look ahead to great opportunities like Bruce C, we want to do everything we can to earn the trust of the Saugeen Ojibwe Nation and have them participate in that. And we have a lot of discussions to have, but I want to raise that, because if we're going to do this energy superpower opportunity right, we have to do it with our communities, municipalities around the site, and our First Nations, and recognize that we have to do it in the spirit of truth and reconciliation. And we're absolutely committed to that. And, you know, I always say, let's not let perfect be the enemy of the good. Let's just make a step forward every single day and make a difference. And it's the action that we take, not the words that we say, that will determine whether or not that future is there. It's very important as a company and as an organization to set some principles and some focus. We can't do everything all at once. We only have so much bandwidth. Now, we need to do things to grow our bandwidth. We shouldn't be satisfied with the bandwidth we have, but we have to stay focused on, you know, what is the right sequence and what is the right way to move forward. And these are our five principles, and I just want to touch on them very briefly. The first is we have existing units, and all of this new opportunity, whether it's new build, whether it's isotopes, it only will happen with a foundation of our existing units being there for the long term. So it's great to talk about we need 75% new power, but we have to secure the power we have. And that is our prime focus at Bruce Power. We have to deliver those safely with quality on time on budget. There is no new product that can replace that output, either in reliability, time frame, or cost. So focusing on those is absolutely important. The second area is, before you talk about building something new, the best thing to do is to look at the asset that we have and say, how do we optimize it? We have a project called Project 2030. The strong support we've had from OMERS and TC Energy and the Society of United Professionals and the PW as our owners have invested up to an additional $1 billion in our plant to optimize the asset. Right now, we are a 6550 megawatt site. If that means anything to people, we were a 6300 megawatt site. We're going to be 7,000. To put it in perspective, 100 megawatts is 100,000 houses. So it's an existing site, an existing asset. Using your existing infrastructure is also makes sense to look at medical isotopes. We have an existing unit. What other products and services can those units provide? And that's why, as I mentioned today, we've announced we will be moving to Unit 6 and to the Bruce A units. And I hope by the time I retire, which will be, I sure hope, well before 2064, we have isotope delivery systems on every unit at Bruce, every unit at Pickering and Darlington, and we are driving the world, but using those existing assets. And then finally, we're pursuing an impact assessment for Bruce C. We have not made a decision to build Bruce C. Our goal is to have the site permitted, to go through that process, and to do this on a step-by-step basis. We've learned from previous large infrastructure projects in Bruce Power, start with the permitting first. Start with early engagement with the SON and Indigenous communities. Start with early engagement with our municipalities in the region around what they need. Complete a technology review. Take it step by step and take it methodically. If we do it right, it will save us time later. And then finally, the economic development, the partnerships. This is not just about building infrastructure, it's about building a future. How do we have a more diverse workforce? How do we have partnerships with First Nations communities like the SON? How do we engage with our communities when it comes to readiness for infrastructure? Those are all important components. It's not what we do, it's also how we do it. Because we want to be sitting here 30 years from now and somebody saying, I grew up in the greatest province and the greatest country in the world. And the reason why that person is able to say that is because of the decisions we make now. And that is what is really, really important. Remember, we're in the people business. It's our people that make everything happy, and we're serving people. It's what it's all about.